William Morrow and Harper Audio present Shakespeare for Squirrels, a novel by Christopher Moore, performed by Euan Morton. The cast.
Pocket,
a fool. Drool, a fool's apprentice. Jeff, a monkey. Puck, or Robin Goodfellow, a fairy, jester to Oberon. Rumour, a narrator. Demetrius, suitor to Hermia. Helena, smitten with Demetrius. Lysander, in love with Hermia. Hermia, Aegeus's daughter, in love with Lysander. Fairies. Cobweb, peas blossom, fluffernutter, mustard seed, moth. The rude mechanicals. Burke, captain of the watch. Tom Snout, a tinker. Snug, a joiner. Nick Bottom, a weaver. Francis Flute, a bellows mender. Peter Quince, a carpenter. Robin Starveling, a tailor. Gritch, a goblin. Talos, a goblin. Titania, queen of the fairies. Oberon, king of the goblins. Theseus, duke of Athens. Hippolyta, queen of the Amazons. Aegeus, chamberlain to the duke. Father of Hermia. Blacktooth, man of the watch. The setting. The setting is a very mythical 14th century Athens and the forest and mountains around it. Shakespeare for Squirrels. Act 1. The jaws of darkness do devour it up, so quick bright things come to confusion. Lysander, A Midsummer Night's Dream, 1-1. Chapter 1. He is drowned, and these are devils. We'd been adrift for 8 days when the ninny tried to eat the monkey. I lay in the bow of the boat, under the moonlight, slowly expiring from thirst and heartbreak, while the great beef-brained boy, Drool, made bumbling snatches for the monkey who was perched on the bowsprit behind my head, screeching and clawing at my jester's hat and jingling his bells in a festive manner. "Sit down, Drool, you'll capsize us."
"Just one wee lick,"
said the giant, grasping the air before him like an enormous baby reaching for his tiny monkey mother. The bow of the boat dove under Drool's weight. Seawater splashed the monkey's bottom. He shrieked and made as if to fling poo at the giant, but it had been 8 days since any of us had eaten, and he could birth no bum babies for the flinging. "There will be no monkey licking as long as I draw breath."
"I'll just give him a bit of a squeeze then."
"No," said I. On the fourth day, after the water ran out, Drool had taken to squeezing Jeff, the monkey, as if he were a wineskin and drinking his wee. But now the monkey was dry, and I feared the next squeeze would produce little but a sanguine monkey marmalade.
"I won't hurt him," said the oaf.
So inept in the lie that he might as well have tied bells on the truth and chased it around the town square while beating a drum. Drool dropped back onto the seat at his end of the dinghy, his weight sending the bow up so rapidly that Jeff was nearly launched into the drink. I caught the monkey and comforted him by slapping my coxcomb over his head and holding it fast until he stopped biting.
"But,"
said Drool, holding a great sausage of a finger aloft as he searched the night for a point.
"Shh! Drool, listen.
I heard something beyond the lap of the waves and the growl of my gut.
What?
I stood in the boat, still hugging the monkey to my chest, and looked in the direction of the noise. A full moon puddled silver across the inky sea, but there, in the distance, lay a line of white.
Surf. It's land, lad. Land! That way, I pointed. Now paddle, you great dribbling ninny. Paddle, lest it be an island and we drift by. I will, Pocket, said Drool. I am. Land's the dog's bollocks, ain't it?
He showed less enthusiasm than the revelation should have engendered.
Land, lad, where they keep food and drink. Oh, right, land, he said, a spark finally striking in the vast, dark empty of his noggin.
The pirates had set us adrift without oars, but Drool's arms were long enough that if he lay down, he could get enough of a hand in the water to paddle. By his sliding from one gunwale to the other, the little boat sloshed slowly forward. My arms would barely reach the water, and as it turned out, though the monkey could swim, even with a sturdy cord tied round his middle, Jeff was complete shit at towing a boat. An hour or so later, what had been a calm sea began to rise up on rollers, and the blue-white lines I'd spotted churned into a briny boil. What had been the distant swish of surf now crashed like thunder before us.
Pocket, said Drool, sitting up, his eyes wide and alight with fear. I don't want to paddle no more. I want to go back.
Nonsense, said I, with enthusiasm I did not feel. Once more unto the breach.
And before I could turn to see where we were headed, a great wave lifted the boat, and we were driven ahead on its face, racing as if on a sled down a never-ending slope. Drool let loose a long, terrified wail and gripped the rails as the stern was lifted, and then we were vertical on the face of the wave. I looked above me to see a great, flailing nitwit flying in the night and a monkey tumbling with him. Then the wave crashed down upon us. I lost my hold on the boat and was awash in a confusion of salt and chill. Over and down and over until there was no up. Nowhere to go for air and no way to get there. Then a light. The moon. A tumble, and there again, the silver above, shining life. I kicked, hoping to find some purchase on sand, but there was nothing but water. Then the moon, and a black spectre diving out of the silver disc above. The boat! I tried to tuck my head, but too late. And then a shock and a flash in the eye as the boat struck me and all was dark.
Oblivion.
There were flames dancing before me when I woke from the dead, which was not entirely unexpected. The devil was smaller and rather younger than I would have guessed. He danced barefoot around the fire as he stoked it in preparation for my torment. The fiend wore a tunic of rough linen, leaves and sticks clinging to it, and a bicocket hat with a single feather in the style of bow hunters back home in Blighty. Bit of a ginger fringe, scrawny and pathetic really for the Prince of Bloody Darkness. As I stirred, the fiend made his way over to me and studied my face. He had wide eyes and high cheekbones, decidedly feminine, which gave him the look of a cat that has been surprised in the middle of his repast of a freshly killed rat, alert and fierce.
He's awake, said the demon.
Pocket, I heard Drool say, at which point pretending to still be dead was a fool's errand.
I looked over to see the great oaf sitting, splayed-legged on the other side of the fire, a massacre of nuts and berries in his lap, the smeared evidence of their fate already streaming down his chin in red rivulets.
Cobweb saved us, said the ninny. She's the git's tits.
She? Said I. So not the devil?
Afraid not,
said the girl. Of course, a girl. I looked over the figure crouched before me like some gamin gargoyle. Right tiny, and in need of a good scrubbing, but I supposed a girl she was, and not a child neither, despite her size.
I didn't do so much of the rescuing as your large friend, she said. On the beach, I jumped up and down on his back until he was breathing again. He carried you up here into the forest.
She leaned into me to whisper.
Methinks he may have taken a blow to the head during the wreck. He seems a bit slow.
Slow is his only speed, I'm afraid.
You took quite a shot to the noggin yourself.
She touched a spot above my forehead, and I winced with the pain.
Covered in blood you were. I cleaned you up.
I touched the tender lump on my head, and bolts of pain shot across the corners of my vision. A deep ache throbbed behind my eyes. Only then did I notice I was lying on a bed of ferns and leaves, naked but for my hat, which had been draped modestly over my man bits.
Your kit is drying still,
said the girl. She shot a thumb over her shoulder to indicate my motley, propped on sticks before the fire, along with my jester's scepter, the puppet Jones.
You want to wash it proper in fresh water when you get a chance. Most of the blood came out in the sea, but not the salt.
What about Jeff? Where's my monkey?
Weren't no monkey, sirrah. Just the big bloke and you.
She held out a leather wineskin.
Here, water. Slowly. Your friend drank it all in one draught, and I had to fetch more at the stream.
How do we chunder? Said Drool.
I took the wineskin and thought I might swoon again as I drank the cool water and felt the fire in my throat abate.
Enough for now,
said the girl, taking back the wineskin.
There's food, too, if the big one's left anything.
I saved you some, Pocket,
said Drool, holding out my codpiece, which was spilling berries as he moved. The girl returned and handed me the codpiece.
Wondered what these things was for?
Thank you, said I. My cod was nearly full of berries and nutmeats.
I thought I might weep for a moment at her kindness and pinch the bridge of my nose as if chasing away a headache.
Your friend says you are fools,
she said, giving me shelter.
I am a fool. Pocket of dog snogging upon ooze, at your service.
I tow a train of titles behind my name. Royal fool, black fool, emissary to the Queen, King of Britain and France. But I thought it ill-mannered to be grandiose while lying on a litter of leaves with only a hat to cover my tackle d'amour. Drool is my apprentice.
We are fools and pirates, said Drool.
We are not pirates, said I. We were set adrift by pirates.
But you were on a pirate ship,
she asked.
For 2 years, said I. There was a girl, a Venetian Jewess, who fancied me. She wanted to be a pirate but became homesick. When she returned to Venice, I was not welcomed to join her.
So you stayed with the pirates?
For a while.
And they set you adrift?
With no food and only enough water for 3 days, the scoundrels.
But why?
They gave no rhyme nor reason, said I.
It was because you're a shit, wasn't it?
No, why would you say that?
Because I only have known one fool, a fellow called Robin Goodfellow, and he, also, is a shit.
I'm not a shit, said I. I am not, that she could prove.
Did you insult them? Make sport of their efforts and appearances? Craft clever puns on their names? Play tricks on the naive and the simple? Compose
rhyme. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.